Alhamdulillah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sallam. We will discuss about Surah Al-Fatiha. This surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mandated upon us to read at least 17 times every day. It's a great surah. There are hadith that discuss about this surah or the greatness of this surah. Many hadith in Sahihain wa Sunnah. This surah, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din, Iyaka na'budu wa Iyaka nasta'in, Ihdina as-sirata al-mustaqim, Sirata al-ladhina an'amta 'alayhim, ghayril maghdubi 'alayhim wadh-dhalin. Is a surah that was given to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a special gift to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Allah jalla wa ala. Let's first explain the surah. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Alhamdu is all the praise. Alif and lam in front of hamd in Arabic means tufidu al-umum or jinsiyah, al-jinsiyah, tufidu al-umum. In Arabic, in English, that alif and lam in front of the word hamd is indicating that all the praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, alhamdulillah, and the lam in lillah is lam al-istihqaq, is deserving lam. That lam means Allah is the one who deserves that all the praise is due to him, subhanahu wa jalla wa ala. So all the praise due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbil alameen, the creator, the founder, the person who, or the individual that created every single alam. Alameen is jam'u alam, and it is plural of alam. Alam could be alam al-jinn, alam al-ins, alam al-hayawanat, alam al-jamadat. Every group have what they call their universe. So the word is universe. Rabbil Alameen, the creator and the founder of the universe is all the universes. The universe of humans, the universe of jinn, the universe of animals, the universe of everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created all of them. So Rabbil Alameen. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. These two names, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, has a meaning. Ar-Rahman is the merciful, the ever merciful to all. So this mercy covers everybody, including the Muslims and the Kuffar. Ar-Rahim, his mercy is exclusive. And it's exclusive for the believers only. And that's the day of judgment. The other group, or he who doesn't believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while they are alive in this dunya, have no mercy from Allah in the day of judgment. And Ar-Rahman, that name, Rahman, there's a conflict of or dispute amongst scholars that Arab knew that name before Quran or not. So some scholars, they say they did not know that that name. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Furqan, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمُ اسْجُدُوا لِلرَّحْمَانِ قَالُوا وَمَا الرَّحْمَانِ. If they are ordered or commanded to prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His name Rahman, they will say وَمَا الرَّحْمَانِ. What is Rahman? And also Sa'ad رضي الله عنه, one of those captives in war of Badr, was a great man. He was a well-spoken person. So he used to give khutbah in Mecca, and he was one of the elders of Mecca. So he used to speech people, to talk to people, and he was full of wisdom. So when he was captured in the day of Badr, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu says, "O Prophet of Allah, cut his tongue, remove his tongue, so he cannot talk about you later on." He says, "No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may bless him and give him a chance to stand up in a place that you as Umar will praise. And what happened, that was one of the prophecies of the Prophet discussing about the future. This man becomes Muslim in Fatah Makkah. And when the Prophet died, Makkah was ruled by a young man, very young man. So he could not handle. And Makkah was about, many Arab Kalanis, they became kuffar. They denounced Islam. They said, we have nothing to do with Islam. Prophet's dead. We have nothing to do with Muslim and Islam. So Makkah was going either or this way or that way. And he could not handle. This man Sa'ad stood up. And he talked to the Quraysh. And he says, you were the last people that came to Islam. Do not be the first that leaves Islam. And he gave very beautiful speech. And that's the speech that Umar will praise him with. That Sa'ad says in the day of negotiation, the reconciliation with the Prophet, they had a negotiation called Hudna. The Prophet writes, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Sa'ad says in that incident, we don't know Rahman. We only know, say Bismillah Umar. We know Allah, but we don't know Rahman. From that perspective, some scholars, they say Arabs did not know the meaning of that name at that time. However, there is an ayah in Surah Zumar that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the kuffar, if they are in trouble, they call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they call Rahman. When they are in hardship, and especially when they are in the sea, or they are in a boat and there is a wind and they think they are about to leave the dunya, they used to call Rahman. Although other scholars say that is Allah is narrating from them in meaning what they mean. However, they did not know. Whatever it is, Ar-Rahman is a name that ulama are all in consensus that no one can name himself Rahman other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ar-Rahim, somebody can call himself Rahim. Because in the Quran, in Surah Tawbah, you can see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling Prophet Muhammad Rahim. Bil mu'minina ra'ufun rahim. He is for the believers, ra'uf, ever merciful for them. And Rahim is also Rahim, is ever merciful. Ra'uf is very caring or feeling for them, for the Muslims. Rahim is ever merciful for them. So the Prophet ﷺ is called Rahim by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That means someone else can have that as a name, Rahim. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, the meaning of Rahman is the one that gives his mercy to all, Muslims, non-Muslims. They enjoy the life of this dunya. Everybody enjoys with the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have children, they have money, they have everything. They have health, they have life, better than yours many times. However, Ar-Rahim is the one that his rahman or mercy is exclusively isolated to the believers only. Only for believers, Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-Din, also it's recited as Maliki yawm al-Din. Maliki, the owner, or the one who owns yawm al-Din, which is Akhirah, or the Day of Judgment, the owner of the Day of Judgment. And if you recite Maliki yawm al-Din, means the king in the Day of Judgment. Al-Din, ma'nahu fi hadhihi al-ayah, the meaning of the Din in this ayah is Jaza wal-Hisab. Jaza wal-Hisab, the day of accountability, the day of reward. Everyone will get what they gave to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if they were good to Allah, they will be good, they will get that goodness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If they were the opposite, they will receive what they have earned in this life. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Maliki yawm al-Din. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Iyaka is maf'ul, or it's the object of the sentence. And in Arabic, object always comes after the subject. However, this ayah, the object comes first. In Arabic, when maf'ul is muqaddam, it has meaning, which is, it makes exclusivity. Iyaka na'budu. You only, and only you will worship. That's what you say. You sign contract with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, I will worship you and only you. That means you will not worship anyone other than Allah besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ, same thing. Again you say, I will not seek help from anyone other than you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then what happens? You say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ. Let me explain a little bit about the isti'ana. Isti'ana is seeking help from someone. This could be something that the person that you are seeking the help from is capable of giving you. For example, you ask somebody to give you $10 or $5 to use for bus fare, and they are capable. So that's not what the ayah is talking about. The isti'ana that you will not serve anyone other than Allah, or you will not direct anyone other than Allah, to anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that something that only Allah affords. For example, you come to someone and you say, I need children, or I need my rizq to be expanded, I need more money for my rizq, or I need the jannah of Allah, or I am sick and I want cure. All those stuff is something that Allah only is capable of. So by asking someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will become a shirk, associating the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with someone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's haram. So إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. You don't serve anyone other than Allah. You don't seek help anyone from anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. إِهْدِنَا, this is dua. And dua starts from here. إِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. إِهْدِنَا, أَوْ اللَّهُ guide us. صِرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ, on the right path. The straight path. You don't know anything more than that. The path is straight. Which path? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will explain more about that path. صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. It's the bath for those who you blessed your shower, you showered your blessings upon. Those who you gave the ni'mah. And you, whenever you give a tafsir of the Quran, you always tafsir Quran bil Quran. Tawil Quran bil Quran. So in Surah Nisa, Allah says what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, من يطع الله ومن يطع الله ورسوله فأولئك مع الذين أنعم الله عليهم من النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحصون أولئك رفيقا ذلك الفضل من الله. Allah says, anyone who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and believes in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as true believing to Allah and to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by following all the commandments of Allah and avoiding and abstaining all the rejections of Allah and His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, those will be with those being blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, including the prophets and the messengers of Allah and the siddiqeen, those who are truthful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, honest to Allah, and then washuhada, martyrs, wassaliheen, and those good doers. So you will be one of those. That's what you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah. Sirat al-ladina an'amta alayhim. I'm asking you the path of those who you've been blessing upon, including the prophets and the martyrs and the salihin and the siddiqeen. Now, غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. You are avoiding or asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save you on falling onto two different paths other than that. And the path, one path is for those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry about. Allah is angry about them. And the path of those who been set astray, they are lost, they are going astray from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their path is not straight. The straight path connects you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly and to the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the blessing of Allah. However, these two other paths are both diverting you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and deviating you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you are asking Allah to save you from those two paths. Scholars, they say, al-maghdubi alayhim hum al-yahud. Wal-dalin, al-dalin hum al-nasar. The group that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry upon are the Yahud, because they know the truth. However, they deny the truth all the time. They denied the truth with Musa alayhi salam. They denied to follow Isa alayhi salam. And they denied to follow Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, they know the truth. In their real Bible, those two individuals are mentioned with descriptions and in details about Isa and details about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yet they deny and they changed and diverted. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is angry about them because they know the truth and they're not following the truth. They're not saying the truth. On the other side, this group are lost and astray because, as you know, Isa alayhi salam was a Jew. And most of the followers of Isa are not Jewish. Only few follow Isa alayhi salam from the Jewish community. The rest are non-Jewish. So they don't know that language, Hebrew. And when Isa alayhi salam, according to them, they think they killed him or they murdered him. The Jewish, they tried to murder him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has uplifted him. And he will come back on earth one day. That's the belief, the right belief, the true belief. And the person they crucified is a person that looked like Isa alayhi salam, but has nothing to do with Isa. When they tried to kill him, they also did not stop right there. They tried to destroy his Bible. So the Torah explains about the descriptions of Isa. However, in Injil, they changed everything about the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Up until they made these people to believe that Jesus was a God. Some of them, they believe Jesus was son of God. Some of them, they believe Jesus is one of three together. The Trinity is what they say, Trinity. Three in one. Ruh al-Qudus, Isa, and Maryam. Allah, Isa, and Maryam together are God, one God, as they believe. So they made them astray. They gave them so many versions of Bible, because the version, the original version was revealed on Hebrew, and they don't understand Hebrew. So the translation comes from enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is enemy of the message. So they are astray. They are following something that was created and fabricated by individualists from the human beings. And they think this is the right, this is the truth, this is the message. So they are astray and lost. Now, you say at the end of the surah, you say Ameen. Ameen is not Arabic word, but it was Arabized. The meaning is Allahumma astajib or Allahumma ajib. This word has a meaning too in Arab. They say Ameen, you can only say to someone who is capable of doing what you're asking. And that's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot say Ameen to anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because Allah is capable of doing anything He wants. However, there is no one in this earth that can fulfill for you a hajj. You have intention. Nobody can fulfill that for you other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah's Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was teaching Abdullah ibn Abbas. And you say, Ya ghulami inni u'allimuka bi kalimatin. Ihfadhi Allah, ihfadhka, ihfadhi Allah, tajidu tujahak. Wa'alam anna al-ummata law ijtama'at ala an yanfa'uka bi shay'in. Lam yanfa'uka illa bi shay'in qad katabahu Allah lak. وَإِنْ اجْتَمَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَضُرُّوكَ بِشَيْءٍ لَمْ يَضُرُّوكَ إِلَّا بِشَيْءٍ قَدْ كَتَبُوا اللَّهُ عَلَيْكَ رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامِ وَجَفَتِ الصُّحْفِ. That hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is teaching his cousin, Abdullah ibn Abbas, as a young boy. He says, oh boy, I teach you something very important. Watch Allah and keep him. He will watch you and keep him. Guard Allah, Allah will guard you. Take care of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of you. And know for certain that you have to be 100% certain that if the entire ummah, all the nations get together to assist you for something, they won't be able to assist you for that something other than something that was prescribed for you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are only capable of doing what was already prescribed for you by Allah 50,000 years before the creation of the heaven and the earth. They, if they, on the other hand, get together to harm you, in one way, they won't be able to harm you in any ways except something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed upon you before the creation of this heaven and the earth, 50,000 years before the creation of this. Now, you don't say Ameen to someone who is not capable of fulfilling what you are asking for. The person who is capable and no one can stand in front of him is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing that can make him stop. Nobody can stop him from doing anything. Now, this surah has secrets. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was saying, Allah says in this surah, this surah has many names. One of them is Surah Al-Fatiha, one of them is Umm al-Kitab, one of them is Umm al-Quran, one of them is As-Salah, as we will see in this hadith, As-Salah. One of them is Kafiya, one of them is Shafiya, one of them is Ruqya. It has many names, and all those names were mentioned by Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, most of them. And many of others are mentioned by the Sahaba of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, or the Tabi'in, or the scholars. When they say Ruqya, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, there is a hadith, a group of Sahaba were traveling, and they came upon some people, non-Muslim group, non-Muslim residents. And they asked them to give them guess, to guess them. And they rejected. They refused to give them anything. Now, as they were residing beside them, and it's a night time, their king was bit by an animal, an insect, or maybe a snake or something, something poisonous. And then he fell on the ground, and he was jumping up and down. And they tried everything, and they would not treat him. So they come to this group. They said, let's go to that group and ask them if they have anything to cure our king. And they asked them to if they know anything. And the leader of the group was very smart man, very smart. Although he didn't have no hadith that talks about ruqya, and he never seen the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم doing it, he had his wisdom, and he did ijtihad. He said, okay, you guys did not give us what we deserve from you as a guest. You did not guest us. So we're not going to guest you, but we're not going to do anything for you and cure your king until you give us something. So they gave them goats, group of goats. They said, all these goats are yours if you cure it. And then he comes to them. He comes to the madlu, the person who was bit by the snake or something. And then he reads this surah for him. And he completely be cured right away. He reads Surah Al-Fatiha, that's it. And then the guy becomes completely healthy and cured from that disease. And then they came, they had disputed him in amongst them. They said, what you did is something that you invented. It's not something that you have learned from Prophet Muhammad. So we cannot accept taking these goats and dividing amongst us and up until we ask the Prophet Muhammad. Then they come to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And when they told the story, he laughed. And that means what? He accepted. He says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ أَنَّهَا رُقِيَةً. And who told you that this surah is رُقِيَةً? رُقِيَةً. Cure. And he says, divide the goats between you and add me as a person. And then he's adding himself into them because he wants them to have feeling good that this is 100% halal, because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is sharing with them. So he said, give me a share. So they shared with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. So that's one of the names. When we say As-Salah, it comes from this hadith that I will mention right now. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, according to Abu Hurairah, and the hadith is reported by Muslim, Muslim rahmatullahi alayh, also all the Sunan, Ibn Majah, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, and Abu Dawud. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, Allah says, according to Abu Hurairah, says, سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول, قالوا, Allah says, the hadith is hadith of words, قسمت الصلاة بيني وبين عبد قسمين. And he calls الصلاة, and he's talking about Surah Al-Fatiha, but he calls it الصلاة. I divided the صلاة between me and my servant into two. One half is for him, and one half is for me. He says, فنصفها له one is for Ali, one is for Ali Abdi. Half of the surah is mine, and half, meaning half of the surah is describing or talking about the attributes and the characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As we said in the tafsir, in the beginning three ayat, you're talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're praising Him, and you're talking about Him. You're describing about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His characteristics and His attributes. And then you respect and dignify Him. And then you sign a contract between you and Him. And that the ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that divides the surah. So three ayat is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This one is shared between the person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the last two ayat is coming for the person alone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, where the person says, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. According to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Hamidani Abdi. Hamidani Abdi. My servant has praised me. He praised me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will respond to you. Some of the salaf, including Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he used to read Fatiha. Every ayah when he reads, he used to pause the room. He used to say, Alhamdulillah, Ya Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Maliki Yawm al-Din. Like that, for the whole surah. He used not to read the other Quran like that. And he was asked, why do you do that? He says, I wait the response of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he waits until he can hear, Hamidani Abdi. I wait the response of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I give him a chance to respond to me. He knows 100% that Allah is chit-chatting with you. Allah is talking to you back and forth. You are discussing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Jalla wa ala fi salah. And that's why the salah, you have to focus and pay attention to the salah. الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِ قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. If you memorize this meaning of this surah, and you pay attention all the times to those ayah that you're reading about the surah, that will give you khushu and focus that you can pay attention to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his responses to you. So he says, Hamidani Abdi, my slave or my servant has praised me. And then what happens? You say, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Allah says, Athna alayya abdi. Athna alayya abdi. My servant is talking about me. He's describing me. He's talking about my attributes, my mercy. And by the way, the mercy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, could be qahhar, could be shadidul iqab, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this surah says, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. He could be al-qahhar aziz, but he did not mention that because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Hadith al-Qudsi, سَبَقْ إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِ إِنَّ رَحْمَتِي سَبَقَتْ غَضَبِ. Indeed, my mercy surpasses and competes my banishment. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives mercy to who he likes and to who he doesn't like, to everyone. In this dunya, everyone is enjoying, and that's because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his mercy. So when you say Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Allah will say, he's talking about my descriptions. He's talking about my attributes, my names. And then when you say Maliki Yawm al-Din, one riwayah says, he says, Majjadani Abdi. Another riwayah says, he says, Fawwada ilayya abdi. The person, my servant, dignified me, honored me, respected me. Or means, Fawwada ilayya amri, Fawwada al-amra ilayya, or Fawwada ilayya, all the umur kulla. He gives his power, or everything that he has to me. He gives up everything up to me. He gives up everything up to me. Either way, you're respecting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm saying I'm relying upon you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are this and this and this. And then you come to this ayah, which is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينُ. When you say this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to you, هَذَا بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ عَبْدِ. This is between me and my servant. So you sign a contract with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every day when you come to the salah. You renew your contract every time you pray. Or every rak'ah you say, you alone I will worship. And you alone, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will seek help from. That's a contract. You sign your life away. Every salah you come, you renew your contract. This is my intention, to worship no one but you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is my intention, to seek help from no one other than you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you say that, Allah will say, this is between me and you. That means as long as you keep the contract, I will keep my contract. As long as you keep your promise, I will keep my promise. And I wonder why he says, هذا لعبدي ولعبدي ما ساء. This is for my servant, and my servant will get what he asks for. And now you are trying, you are starting to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala something. You say, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Oh Allah, guide us. Guide us to the right path or to the straight path. When you say that, you continue. صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. And you mention the path, the specific path that you are asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you finish the two ayah, Allah will say, هذا لعبدي ولعبدي ما ساء. This is for my slave, or for my servant, and my servant gets what he asked for. What did he ask for? Guidance. Who gives guidance other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Nobody. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who guides me. You know Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, loved so much and tried so hard to convert his uncle, Abu Talib, the father of Ali ibn Abi Talib, to Islam. Because his uncle was his the pillar that saved him from all the hardships and all the intentions of the Quraysh, at the time of Quraysh. And all the problems did not start up until he died, as you know. They even cut Abu Talib and all the family of the Prophet ﷺ off 3 years, saying nobody can buy anything from them, nobody can sell anything to them. They were isolated, completely contained, up until they even ate shoes made out of leather. They cook it and they made meat from it. That was the hardship they went through. And they gave choice to Abu Talib to save his family, the rest of the family, and accept Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be murdered. And he says, they said, we will give you the one, the boy in Quraysh that's the most courageous person, the most powerful, the most handsome, the most outspoken person in Quraysh. We'll give you that guy in replacement for Muhammad, and we will kill Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says to them, he says, do you see that cow? Yes, a cow with a cup. He says, if that cow remove his child and give him another child, if that cow accepts the new child, and then I will accept the child that you are telling, the son that you are telling me will be my son in replacement of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They said, nobody can make that cow accept the new child or a child that's not his. He says, am I more moron than a cow? Is that what you think? How can I accept someone else in replacement with my son? He used to love Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam the most. And his father told him to be good to that boy. His father, Abdul Muttalib, said when he was dying, the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was dying, he said to Abu Talib, I want you to do one thing for me. And he says, what is it for all my father? He says, take care of this boy. Be good to him. And he used to sit him beside him. In the time of Arab, they used to have what they call majlis. Everybody, every big guy, had a place in the house that he only sits on a chair for the man of the house, or a place for the man of the house. The only child allowed to sit on that chair or in that place was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not even his kids and his children. They were not allowed to come anywhere closer to that. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the only one. And many times he was a poet. And there are many poems that he made about the religion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He even says, I don't believe there is a religion better than the religion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet he failed to become Muslim. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, was given Jawami'ul Kalim, short words that carry so much meaning. He could be the person that can speak to anyone right to the heart. He has been guiding people for the sake of Allah towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that was bi-idhnih. And then he could not guide his uncle to become a Muslim. And what happens? When he was about to die, he sits on his right side, and Quraysh elders was sitting on the other side, and he's talking to his uncle. He says, "Oh, uncle, one word, كلمةً أحاج لك بها عند الله. One word that I will dispute or debate for you in the day of judgment for Allah, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just one word, before you die." He says, "My son, you know how much I love you? You're asking me for one word? 1,000 words." He says, 1,000 words, I will say it for you. Only one? He says, "قُلْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ." Just that word, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. There's no God other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the other guys go and say, "أَتَرْضَبُ عَنْ مِلَّةِ عَبْدِ الْمُطَلِبِ." Are you afraid now? You're dying? Is that why? Are you coward? Chicken? Huh? You chicken out now? You're listening to this little boy? Are you leaving the religion of your father behind? And what happens? The last word he says is, "هُوَ عَلَى مِلَّةِ عَبْدِ الْمُطَلِبِ." I am on the religion of my father. And he dies. The Prophet ﷺ cried so hard. He left disappointed the scene. And when he was leaving, this ayah was revealed. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You don't guide those who you love. Allah is the one who guides who he so wishes for the guidance for. And that's what you're asking, اِهْدِنَا الصَّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. You're asking Allah to give you guidance. And in the day of judgment, when the believers come, they will say, الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. Our blessing or all praise are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that guided us to this. We've been guided this way by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And had he not guided us in those days, we would not be guided at all, is what they say. لولا أن هدانا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا. And we would not be guided had he not guided us in those days in the dunya. They say, Alhamdulillah. So the guidance is what you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And guidance is more lovely and more beneficial and more valuable than anything in your life. Because this life is short. This life is short. You're gonna die one day. You can live in this dunya 100 years, the maximum. What happens? After that, you die. عِشْ مَا عِشْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيْتٌ. Live as long as you want, because you are dead one day. And what happens? When you die, there's afterlife. There's another life that will begin after you die, or the day of judgment, and that life never ends. So if you're successful in that life, if you are successful in that life, being loser in this life is nothing compared to that. However, if you can be successful in this one and that one, that is the best thing that can happen for anyone. So you're asking Allah guidance. And that guidance will cover both. It covers the guidance of this dunya and the guidance of akhirah. Most probably, anyone who is guided has good life in this dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nahl, Allah says, those who believe in Allah and do good deeds. فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا. We will give them life that is the best amongst all lives. We will give him the best life in this dunya. مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبًا وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. بِأَحْسَنِ الَّذِي كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they will have the best life in this dunya. And in the day of judgment, Allah will look at their deeds. And then he will pick the best one amongst the deeds that they had in this dunya. And then he will reward them, that best one, applied to all of them. So if you have one deed, that will give you 100% rewards. And you have so many deeds, that will give you 10% or 5%. Your salah was most of the time is 5% or 10% or 20% or 30%. However, you have one time you have 100%. You gave attention, you had the khushu, you did everything according to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You prayed as you have seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying in the books of the Sunnah, Bukhari, Muslim, and Sunnah, Hadith Sahih. And then you accommodated all those in your salah, and you get 100% reward on that salah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply all your salawat, all your prayers to that deed, which is the best. So you get the salah 100%. If you have one day fasting 100%, that will be applied to all of them. All the days that you fast, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will apply that rewards, the best rewards amongst it. وَلَنَجْزِيَنَا أَحْسَنَ الَّذِي كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ أَحْسَنَ الَّذِي كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ The best amongst all the things that they did in the past. Now, you ask Allah guidance, He will give you life in this dunya, good life. What happens if you avoid Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you disregard His call? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى قَالَ رَبِّ لِمَ حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا قَالَ كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى In that ayah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever abandons our dhikr, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't follow the mandates of Allah and the sharia of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't follow who, he doesn't follow the commandments of Allah and the commandments of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah says, we will give his life as difficult as possible. So you have all that money. Remember, how many people, how many billionaires you heard committed suicide? Billionaires. They get all the money. They can have the best life that anybody can have in this dunya. However, they don't have something that's called tranquility or happiness. The happiness or the sa'ada is coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ The hearts get happiness through the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if you don't have remembrance of Allah, you are always missing something. And you are always looking for something. And you are always seeking behind something. You are following behind something and you're not locating that something. Regardless of how much money you have, regardless of how many children you have, or how many wives you have, or how many things that people appreciate in this dunya you have, you are still missing something. And that something is the tranquility of the heart. And hearts, as the way that Allah created for them, the way that Allah created, the only thing that gives them tranquility and happiness and patience is dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember Imran case? That big company that fell sometime, there was allegation. What happened to the vice president? He shot himself. And he was a billionaire. He was very young. Why? Because there's no life there. There's no life there. As long as you don't have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your life, you have nothing. So Allah will make you. Allah says, وَأَنَا عَرُضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ We will make sure that his life is full of hardship. He will never have patience. He is either afraid or nervous or just looking for something. He will never have patience and tranquility. And in the day of judgment, we will resurrect him blind, is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. And when he comes blind and he says, Oh Allah, why did you make me blind? I used to see in the dunya. Allah says, وَكَذَلِكَ أَعْتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ كَذَلِكَ عَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيْتَ Same like that. Our ayat, signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came to you. And you did not look at it like you are blind. You forgot Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You forgot the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ تُنْسَى Today, you are forgotten. Left behind. Have nothing to do with Allah's mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's the day of judgment. This surah, another hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to Abdullah ibn Abbas, and the same hadith is also narrated by Muslim too. Abdullah ibn Abbas says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was baynama Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, baynama Jibreel julusum inda Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, id sami'a naqidan min fawq, farafa'a rasahu ila sama' faqala hada babun futiha al-yawm. ولم يفتح قبل اليوم قط ثم قال هذا ملك فنزل ملك ثم قال هذا ملك نزل إلى الأرض اليوم ولم ينزل من قبل قط. فسلم أي سلم جبريل على الملك الذي نزل من ذلك الباب. فقال الذي نزل من ذلك الباب قال أبشر بنورين لم يؤتهما أحد قبله. سورة الفاتحة وآخر آيتين سورة البقرة بنورين. I heard Shia saying نورين is حسن and حسين. They say many things. That's the easiest thing they can say. I was watching a movie, a video in the YouTube, a man, old man, I think he was 60 or 70, between 70 or 80. He was saying, Hussein, who are Rabbuna? He says, Hussein is our Lord. Another one I watched, he says, Ali is Allah. And that guy that says, Hussein is Rabbuna, he says, in the day of judgment, he is the one who will judge us. So Hussein is the judge in the day of judgment. When Adam, alayhi salam, and all the prophets, all the messengers are falling on the ground and saying, Nafsi, Nafsi. This man believes Hussein is the judge. He says, who are we? And that's shirk. Al-kufr al-akbar. Al-ridda al-Islam. And anyone who believes that will be out of Islam. It's a religion other than Islam. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of Hussein and Ali and everyone. And he is the one who is going to take Ali and Hussein into accountability. He will take them accountable to their deeds in the past. They will stand in front of him and they will report and be accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have nothing to do with this judgment. Allah is the one who is judging between people. And if you have doubt about that, you're not Muslim. Period. Done. Regardless of your claim, you can say I'm Muslim or I'm this. Or if you can call anybody other than Allah a Rabb or a judge in the day of judgment, then you are not Muslim. So this is what happened. Allah's Prophet ﷺ was sitting with Jibreel. And then Jibreel hears sound of like opening door from the sky. And then he looks up and he says, this is a door or a gate that has never been opened before. And then he says, there is an angel. It's open today, but it was never been opened before. And then he says, there is an angel coming from that door. And this angel is coming down on the ground. He never ever came on the ground before. So this is a special occasion. There has to be a special thing going on. And then the angel that came on earth talks to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says, Abshir du Nurain. Have a glad tidings on two lights. Two lights were given to you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that was never been given to anyone before. All the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were not given these two lights. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given those two nurain, or those two lights, and one of them is Surah Al-Fatiha. And the second one is the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Amana al-Rasul bi anzila ilayhi wa rabbi ila akhir surah. And then he says, everything that you ask in those two nurain, or those two lights, will be granted to you. So if you read Surah Al-Fatiha, this is the verse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you read Surah Al-Fatiha, and you read what? اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give it to you. So that will be granted to you. So just pay attention when you say it. Pay attention to when you're reading that surah. This surah is very important. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to repeat it every day at least 17 times. 17 times you pray farm, 17 rak'ah. Every rak'ah that you pray, you have to read the Surah Al-Fatiha. I'm not talking about the khilaf between the scholars. If you are ma'mum or imam, who's going to, and the salah is jahriya, like maghrib or isha or fajr, who's going to read the surah? You don't have to read according to some of the scholars. And according to some of the scholars, regardless of being Imam or Ma'mum, you have to read. Either way, either khilaf is fine, because they both have dalil. Although I believe the dalil that says you don't have to recite anything after the Imam, when the Imam is loud, have the power of the proof over the other ones, because the Prophet ﷺ says in a hadith, according to Abu Huraira, one day he says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَكْرَعُونَ خَلْفَ إِمَامِكُمْ. Maybe you are reading or reciting after your Imam. قَالُوا هَدَّنْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Quickly, we do. He says, لَا تَفْعَلُوا. لَا تَفْعَلُوا. Don't do that. Don't do that. إِلَّا أَن تَقْرَعُوا بِفَاتِحَةَ الْكِتَابِ. Except if you read Surah Al-Fatiha. And then he says, another day, after that, another day, the Prophet ﷺ says, leave it alone to me. And then he says, فَانْتَهَى النَّاسُ عَنِ الْقِرَاءَةِ كُلِّهَا فِي مَا جَهَرَ فِيهِ الْإِمَامِ وَقَرَعُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ مَا لَا يَجْهَرُ فِيهِ الْإِمَامِ. And this is looks like nasakh. He says, one day, another day after that, he says, don't even read the Surah Al-Fatiha. Just leave it alone. Leave it up to me. And he says, and then people, he's talking about the Sahaba, they stop reading after the Prophet ﷺ, as long as the Imam is reading loud. And they used to read it in themselves when the Imam is not doing jahr. Like when it's not Maghrib or Isha or Fajr, they used to read it themselves. From that hadith, another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَنْ كَانَ لَهُ إِمَامٌ فَقِرَاءَةُ الْإِمَامِ قِرَاءَةٌ لَهُ وَقِرَاءَ تَعُمْ الْفَاتِحَ وَغَيْرِهِ. So, we're not talking about that khilaf right now, and we cannot fix it. That khilaf has been since the Sahaba, and he will be there until the day of judgment. And either way is fine, because every group has dalil sahih. And understanding of the deen, people are different in understanding the dalil and making verdict upon the dalil. People are different. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, it's the rahmatun min Allah. Allah could make it concrete, but he made this rahmatun minhu's jalla wa'ala. Anyways, when you're reading that surah, pay attention. And when you read 17 times a day, if you are alone or imam. If you are alone or imam. Or if you believe that you have to read. If you don't read, if you don't believe you don't read, for the first two rak'ah of Maghrib and the first two rak'ah of Isha and two rak'ah of Fajr, you miss six times. And the Prophet ﷺ says in that hadith, فَقِرَاءَةُ الْإِمَامِ قِرَاءَةٌ. Anyone who has imam, the recitation of the imam is recitation for him. So you get the credit. So you still are someone who read 17 times. And you can read more than that, because all the times you pray sunnah. You pray tahiyyat al-masjid, you pray harawati, you pray salatul layl, maybe witr. You pray so many rak'ah a day. Some scholars used to pray 300. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As used to pray 300 rak'ah every day. So he is going to read 300 times that surah. So that is the secret of this surah. You are repeating over and over again, because the surah is really great surah to you and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, that hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, these two nur that was given to him, and that special occasion of opening that gate that was never been opened before, and revealing that angel that was never been revealed before, it was that occasion for this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha. So the surah is the greatest surah of the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Sa'id ibn al-Ma'la, Ya Sa'id, he called Sa'id, and Sa'id was praying, and he did not respond to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَلَمْ أَجِبُهُ فَقُلْتُ أُصَلِّي فَلَمْ أَجِبُهُ ثُمَّ أَتَيْتُهُ فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إِنِّي كُنْتُ أُصَلِّي فَقَالَ أَلَمْ يَقُلِ اللَّهِ اسْتَجِيبُوا لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ إِذَا دَعَاكُمْ لِمَا يُحْيِيكُمْ. And he says, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in the hadith, لَوْ عَلِّمَنَّكَ سورة أعظم سورة في القرآن قبل أن تخرج من المسجد اليوم. فأخذ بيدي فأراد أن يخرج فقلت له يا رسول الله لم تقل لو علمنك سورة أعظم سورة في القرآن اليوم. قال الحمد لله رب العالمين. And then he reads the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم according to Sa'id ibn al-Ma'la, Sa'id was praying and the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم called him and he did not respond because he was in prayer. And then when he finished the prayer, he came to Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ, he excuses himself to Prophet ﷺ, saying, I was in a prayer. That was the only thing that prevented me to respond to you. He says, Allah didn't say, didn't Allah say subhanahu wa ta'ala, istajibu lillahi wa rasooli la da'a, wa lir rasooli la da'a kun ba'li. Didn't Allah say, always respond to Allah and to His Messenger when they call you for something that will give you life, will give you real life in your heart, and the heart is alive when it's given dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Quran or hadith, and dead when there's no Quran in the heart. So that's what it is. And then he says, I will teach you today the greatest surah in the Quran, greatest surah in the Quran, before you leave the masjid. And he says later on, he grabs my hand and he wants to leave the masjid. I say, oh, wait, didn't you say you're going to teach me something? It's the greatest surah in the Quran before I leave the masjid. He says, yes, it's Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. And that is a hadith that the Prophet ﷺ, he says at the end, أعطاني الله سبحانه وتعالى من كنز تحت عرشي. Allah gave me this surah from a safe under the Arsh al-Rahman, under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was kept there. It was privately kept for me, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to me from that kanz, from that safe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This surah has names. One of the names is Kafiya. Kafiya, meaning you can give up on something upon because of so it can give you what is it?
Sufficiency.
Yes, it can give you sufficiency from the rest of the Quran. For example, if you are praying, if you know only Fatiha and read only Fatiha, your prayer is accepted. But any other surah cannot replace it. You have to know the Fatiha if you pray. If you don't know, that's another thing. If you cannot know, like that sahabi that came to Prophet ﷺ and says, إِنِّي لَا أَسْتَطِعُ أَنْ أَخُذَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ شَيْءٍ. There is no possibility for me to take anything from the Quran. I cannot learn anything from the Quran. And he says, how do I pray? He says, SubhanAllah, Alhamdulillah, Wallahu Akbar. And then he used to pray with that. He doesn't read Fatiha, he doesn't read anything else, he doesn't. We're not talking about a special case, we're talking about general. You pray, you have to read Surah Al-Fatiha. You have to read Surah Al-Fatiha. And that's what it is. So this surah was given that name because it can give you sufficiency from other Quran. But there's no Quran that can give you sufficiency from Surah Al-Fatiha. It's called also Shafiya. There is another name called Kamila. It's containing everything that was in Torah and in Injil and in Furqan. It's Ummul Quran, the mother of the entire Quran. Ummul Kitab, the mother of the Quran. So it has many names. Regardless, this is the greatest surah. And if somebody asks you which one is the greatest surah in the Quran, that's Fatiha. Which verse is the greatest verse in the Quran? So Ayat al-Kursi. So Ayat al-Kursi is the greatest ayah. This is the greatest surah in the Quran. And the person, as we explained it before, is talking straightforward with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he's praying, and Allah is responding straight back to them. Whenever they say something, Allah will say something back to them. قُلُ مَا تَسْمَعُونَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَى سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ.
What about the last two verses of Surah Baqarah? Amana Rasulullah Ma'amdullah.
Those two ayat is the same thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we were not discussing about them. That's why I just mentioned and left. Those two ayat was revealed with this surah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, when you're sleeping in the night time, read those two surah. And what happens, they will anyone who recites those two surah before sleep will be sufficient. They will be sufficient for you to cover you from the shayateen and from the getting astray. And the two ayah, the last ayah has dua, big dua, the last portion of the ayah is dua. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا ربنا ولا تحمل علينا إصرا كما حملته على الذين من قبلنا ربنا ولا تحملنا ما لا طاقة لنا به واعف عنا واغفر لنا وارحمنا أنت مولانا فانصرنا على قوم الكافرين. So all those are dua that you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you something. And Prophet ﷺ was promised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he will give every one of you, if they read the ayah, Allah will give the meaning of the ayah. So what is it? رَبَّنَا لَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْكَ إِسْرًا لَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْكَ إِسْرًا كَمَهَا لَا تُحَمِلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا إِلَّا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِنَّ سِينَ وَخْطَانَ. Let's start from there. لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِنَّ سِينَ وَخْطَانَ. Oh Allah, do not judge us when we forgetful and we're not paying attention. لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِنَّ سِينَ وَخْطَانَ. You're not paying attention, you made a mistake. The mistake is not going against you. Allah will forgive that mistake. Even if it's kufr, will not go against you. Will not go against you. And if you forgot something, for example, you forgot the salah and you did not pray, you will pray when you remember. And there's no sin upon you. The salah is there for you because this is out of your ability, out of your power. Your brain is limited and Allah make you forgetful. So when you forgot something, Allah will not take you accountable for that. رَبَّنَا لَا تُؤَخِذْنَا إِنْ نَسِينَا أَوْ أَخْطَأْنَا. رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْنَا إِصْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَ وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِنَا. Oh Allah, did not mandate upon us something that we cannot afford. For example, the religion is before us. The only place they could pray was to go to the jar. They have to go to the church. Now in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved us from that. You can pray in your workplace. You can pray in your house. You can pray on the street. Yesterday I prayed on the street. I was doing something in an office, and when I came out, I realized the Asr is about to leave. And there's only a few minutes left from the sun to sit. So I parked it on the street, and I had my sajada in the car, and I took it out and I prayed on the street. So you can pray anywhere. And Prophet ﷺ says, the earth or the sand or the ground was made for me tahur, something that I can wudu with. If you have najasa in your feet, in your shoes, this is the tahara, is on the ground, is the sand. And if you don't have water, the wudu will be, your wudu will be a sand. Dust will give you wudu. And he says, masjid, you can pray anywhere. So he says, anyone that the salah comes upon, he should pray wherever he is. You can pray in anywhere in the world except many places, few places, like the washroom, like in the middle of the street. You cannot go and pray in 17th Avenue. What's going to happen? All the cars will stop, or they will kill you, or somebody will be in trouble. No, you can't do that. Al-qari'at al-tariq is not allowed. Al-hamam is not allowed. And then also it's not allowed in the place that camel is sitting. You can pray in the goats, but you cannot pray in the camels and the cows, barracks. You can pray with the goats. It's a different. But you cannot pray with those. You're not going there. Anyway, رَبَّنَا وَلَا تَحْمِلْ عَلَيْهِ إِسْرًا كَمَا حَمَلْتَ عَلَيْهِ. رَبَّنَا وَلَا تُحَمِّلْنَا مَا لَا طَاقَةَ لَنَا بِهِ. Oh Allah, do not mandate upon us something that is difficult to be accommodated. وَعْفُ عَنَّا, forgive us. وَغْفِرْ لَنَا, وَعْفُ عَنَّا وَغْفِرْ لَنَا, the same in English, forgive us. And relieve us from the sin. وَصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقُمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. And when the kuffar attacks us, oh Allah, give us the victory over them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the Muslims the victory. Any other question?
I heard the Surah Ikhlas was, it came in as a Surah Ikhlas and Ayatul Kursi being, Surah Ikhlas is it?
The greatest ayah? Great Surah? Surah, yeah. No. Ikhlas is, Surah Al-Ikhlas is, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, three Ikhlas equals the Quran. Surah Al-Ikhlas equals the Quran. Okay. So three of them will give you the, if you read three Qul Huwa Allah, equal is like you read the whole Quran. And there is a hadith the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says to a Sahabi, there was a group of Sahaba traveling, and one of them was in charge. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent them somewhere, so he was in charge. So anytime he reads Quran, he's the imam. When you are in charge, you lead the prayer. So anytime he reads the Quran and the salah, and he's about to do ruku, he reads Surah Al-Ikhlas at the end. So when he finishes his qira'ah, maybe he's reading a page from Surah Al-Baqarah, and when he finishes it, he's about to do ruku, he reads Qul Huwallahu Ahad at the end, and then he makes ruku. And then when they came back, they didn't see the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam doing the same, so they were like, they didn't like it. So they came to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and they complained to him about it. They said to this man, stop what you're doing. And he says, if you want to pray behind me, this is the way I will lead you as a prayer, as an imam. This is the way I will lead you. You either take it or leave. And they were angry. So they came to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They complained to him about it. And what did he say? He says, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, ask him, why did he do that? And they come and ask him, why did you do that? He says, I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the surah is full of descriptions of Allah, attributes of Allah, characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What does it say? It will describe when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asking by the Quraysh, Sif lana rabbak. They said, we have Lata and Uzza and Hubal and all that. We have idols and they have names. Tell us your Lord. Who is your God? Explain to us who is he. Allah revealed this surah. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا. So characteristics of Allah from A to Z. So he says, I love it because I love Allah and his characteristics, and this surah mentions the characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what happens? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, tell him, بِحُبِّهَا إِيَّاهَا يَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةِ. Tell him that because he loves that surah, he will go to the Jannah. So that surah is great surah, no doubt. But the greatest surah in the Quran is Surah Al-Fatihah. أعظم سورة في القرآن, according to Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, is Surah Al-Fatihah. Done, right?
You said the secrets of Fatiha, one was the cure, right?
And the second, the names, one, many of them.
The secrets of Fatiha.
It has so many names. So one of them is. You chit-chatting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're talking to Allah, speaking to Allah. And also, it gives you something that you ask for. It's a guarantee. It's a guarantee from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will get what you said in the prayer. And Allah never breaks his promise. And Allah la yukhlifu al-mi'ad. You say, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ الصِّرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ. And Allah says, هَذَا لِعَبْدِي وَلِعَبْدِ مَا سَأَلَ. That's for my servant, and my servant will get what he asked for. So what's more than that? What's better than that? That's the greatest secret of that surah. You're talking to Allah when you are praying. And when you know that hadith, the salah will make sense to you. The salah will make sense to you. Because you're talking to Allah, you pay attention. You know the meaning, you know what you're saying, and you know what you're expecting from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say back to you. And you're listening, that you have imagination of listening to the words of Allah back to you. Hamidani abdi. Athana alayya abdi. Majjadani abdi. Oh, fawwata ilayya abdi. Hada bayni wa bayna abdi. Wali abdi masal. Hada li abdi wa li abdi masal. So you have imagination that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is responding to you when you say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, all the times until you finish the surah. So that's the greatest secret that the surah has. It's a great meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking back and forth to you. We're done, right? Barakallahu. Salaam alaikum.